I would like to start thanking the Sylvia Ioannou Foundation for organizing this conference and for inviting us. I'm sure that the knowledge we share in this conference will lead to further research in our geography. Now, researchers of cartography, as we all know, are often geographers or cartographers themselves who examine maps for their content in view of science, the science of map making, while the illustrations on the maps are often overlooked. However, a study of historical maps and sea charts indicates that cartographers have considered map making both as a science and as an art, aiming to record the different parts of the world, not only with their topographical details, but also with their history. Therefore, city views, costumes, flora, and fauna, and even portraits found on certain maps have brought them close to works of art, especially those produced in map workshops for commissioners. Links between mapping and picturing date back to the Roman and medieval times, but it's the real explosion of geography in the 16th century that led to the production of a great number of illustrated maps and sea charts, especially on the Mediterranean, by the Italians, Catalans, and Portuguese, as well as the Ottomans. This was the result of the expeditions leading to new trade routes and naval traffic, as well as battles and conflicts arising among the Mediterranean nations. All these naturally required current knowledge of geography and navigation and necessitated the production of atlases and sea charts. Some of these produced in Venetian, Catalan, or Ottoman workshops as special copies to be presented to rulers or rich collections include plan views of certain harbors and cities with added legends concerning historical facts. A study of such maps or sea charts from the Mediterranean reveals the interplay between diverse cultures on the Mediterranean and especially political and cultural relations between the Ottomans and the Mediterranean countries. Catalan and Italian cartographers preparing maps and sea charts for their patrons seem to have developed a special interest in contemporary history. A study of such maps or sea charts from the Mediterranean reveals the interplay between diverse cultures. I'm sorry, I repeated myself. For example, one of the best plan views of Constantinople during Byzantine rule was drawn by Cristoforo Buodelmonte, as you well know, in his Liber Insularum, the peak on the islands, in 1430, which still is a real document for the city and monuments. Approximately 60 years later, the city was depicted in Liber Chronicarum, printed in Germany in 1492, as a Byzantine town with no monuments added during the reign of Mehmed II. Some Italian cartographers, such as Jacopo Maggiolo in 1541, did depict Constantinople under Muslim rule, but it's, as you can see, it's a turbaned figure holding a large, large dagger that symbolizes the Muslim rule. On the other hand, the Venetian cartographer Battista Agnese, active in the second quarter of the 16th century, in his extensively illustrated maps and atlases covering different parts of the world, was much more accurate, and his interest in political history, as you see on the image, is explicit in the depictions of rulers of all the European countries, even Scottish and English kings, and the Pope. And what's interesting is he had a keen interest for the Eastern rulers as well. And as you see, the Ottoman Sultan Suleiman the Magnificent is depicted on his throne in Anatolia. And what's interesting, again, about this map is that he does indicate the conquest of Syria in Egypt by Sultan Selim, as you can see in the right image. But a scene of crucifixion is depicted about Jerusalem, although taken by the Ottomans. Now, Ottoman interest in geography was enhanced with the reign of Sultan Mehmed II, who was deeply interested in geography and had acquired a rich collection of geographical sources for the Ottoman court. Illustrated maps from the Islamic world as well as European sources, including this interesting Arab world map, as you see, commissioned by the Abbasid Caliph in the first quarter of the 19th century, but copied by Al-Amari, who had himself translated Ptolemaios' work into Arabic. However, as you can see, it does not depict Africa as a continent, but shows the Indian Ocean as an open sea, as you can see the, this is the pointer. Anyway, you'll see it. And it's quite interesting because it shows the Indian Ocean as an open sea and an ocean surrounding the continents of the world. Demanding a more scholarly work on geography, Mehmed II consulted the Greek scholar Georgios Amorites from Trebizond, and a copy of the Italian translation of Ptolemaios' Geographicae by Francesco Berlinghieri, the Florentine geographer, was dedicated to Mehmed II. And a military map of the Venetian Republic was also commissioned by Mehmed II, which is marked by the illustrations of bridges and guard towers, as you can see in detail. Now, the 16th century saw the production of several maps and sea charts by the Ottomans. And the Ottoman expansion policy in the Mediterranean resulted in the exaltations of Syria and Egypt, followed by the Siege of Rhodes, signaling Ottoman supremacy in the Aegean by the 1520s. This continuing interest in campaigns in the Mediterranean certainly necessitated a powerful fleet and extensive geographical material. Of course, there's no doubt that it was Piri Reis, the famous seaman and cartographer of the period of Selim I and Suleiman the Magnificent, who blazed the trail of cartography and illustrated maps. He was the nephew of corsair and sea captain Kemal Reis and accompanied him in the Turco-Venetian War. And then he joined the fleet in 1517 that sailed to Alexandria on the Egyptian campaign of Selim I. And during Suleiman's reign, he joined the naval fleet on the campaigns to Belgrade, Rhodes, and also served in the fleet of Admiral Barbarossa on the Mediterranean in 1537. In 1547, he was appointed as commander by the Indian commander of the Indian Ocean fleet, and moving on to the Arabian Sea, fighting with Portuguese or Hormuz, there was an unfortunate incident of retreatment and for which he was accused and as we all know, he was beheaded. But Piri Reis is best known for this world map, and he also has a second map. But this map, made for Selim I in 1513, was presented to the Sultan during his Egyptian campaign in 1517. And it's interesting because the Second World War, world map, which he also did, was presented to Suleiman. They are all illustrated. That's why I'm just showing these as the initial examples. As you can see, ships, cities, rulers, animals, and legendary creatures, as you can see on the right image actually were portrayed on this world map, which is believed to be based on Christopher Columbus's world map and several other sources. But you see all these, the interest in illustrating maps and with all the information written by Piri Reis, which we will also follow, we will also trace this in his copies of the Kitab-ı Bahriye, because all this detailed information on the maps indicate that his aim was not only draw the map itself, for which, for all of his maps, he undoubtedly consulted European samples, but he wanted to spread the knowledge of the new geographical discoveries. Now, Kitab-ı Bahriye, of course, is the primary representative of Ottoman cartography, and it's a guidebook giving sailing directions for seamen. And it certainly resembles these sea charts, portolas, isolari, popular since the 15th century. But it's also a major source for history of geography and cartography, because the book is primarily based on his personal observations and experiences. And in his introduction, he gives all the information about the sources that he consulted. And now there are nearly 40 copies of the Kitab-ı Bahriye, and there are two versions of the Kitab-ı Bahriye, which we will try to summarize. And he says in all his introductions that traveling with his uncle Kemal Reis and his fellow seaman, he recorded all the details that were not given by maps. And again, I repeat, he saw more value in text, in the text, and he minimized the sea charts, actually. He called them şekils, you know, just drawings, forms. And each chapter devoted to castles and fortified ports covers a specific region on the Mediterranean, accompanied by charts and drawings. And he starts his voyage in Gelibolu, where there was an arsenal, and the Dardanelles, and through the Aegean Sea, Dalmatian, as we know, Italy, South France, Spain, North Africa, and then around the Mediterranean back. But it was produced in two versions. And when I show these images, I'll mention which is which version, so that we can at least try to compare them in content and in style. Of course, the first version was completed in 1521, and it has a shorter text consisting of 130 charts. And Grand Vizier Damat Ibrahim Pasha used it on his expedition to Egypt in 1524, and he commissioned Piri Reis, who was accompanying him, to produce a more elaborate version of the Kitab-ı Bahriye for the reigning Sultan Süleyman. And actually, the second version includes prayers and an account of the book, how the book was written, giving information on discoveries and even biographical information about Kemal Reis, uncle, and Piri Reis himself. And these are followed by sections in verse written by writer Seyit Muradi in 1525-6, and it's more extensive with 210 charts. So there are main differences between the two versions, and several copies of both the first and the second version were made in the following centuries. The first more for mariners, and the second undoubtedly intended for presentation as a work of art and enjoyment, and all these samples we have been talking about. And copies made in the following centuries had some additional charts and views reflecting the artistic milieu of the relative period. And so The city views in several copies, different copies of the Kitab-ı Bahriye produced through the centuries reflect the patronage and the artistic milieu in which they were produced. And in the later expanded copies of the Kitab-ı Bahriye, the illustrations are better in quality and they reflect the developments in Ottoman painting at that period. Now, the Sylvia Ioannou Foundation copy, and I'll call it the Foundation copy, is an 18th century copy of the first version. And a comparative study on the several copies of the first version certainly reveals the different interpretations of the charts. And the copy does not have a detailed chart of the Dardanelles, as you see here on the left, the first copy of the first version, and on the right you see the another copy of the first version, and we will trace this also in comparing with the foundation copy. Now, you see here the second version of a Kitab-ı Bahriye in the Topkapı Palace, and you see the Sema direct, and you see on the right, sorry, this should be, it's misspelled, that's Sema direct, I'm sorry. Please excuse me, it was misspelled. Of course, it's the same Sema direct that you have on the left, and it's the copy of, you know, the copy in the foundation, and it's Samothrace, of course, the island Sema direct, which is usually found on the first version, and has the islands around sometimes, but Piri describes it, I'm talking about the image on the right, as a roundish mountain, and says that there is always snow on the summit, on its summit. And he mentions the ruined monasteries on the land, on the island, and indicates that one of the castles is still standing, opposite which there is the cape, Kadır Kapurnu. Much more detailed is the shoreline with Salonika. Saloniki, and you see the foundation copy, and you see another copy in the of the first version in the Austrian National Library, and it is actually, as you can see, Salonika is described in the text as a large city surrounded by a castle with bastions. And although he mentions that 300 ships can be accommodated, there are no drawings of ships. This is another point we have to make. And this is true with many copies of the earlier versions, whereas in the copies of the second version, several types of ships are depicted even in motion. And you can compare these, but see that the foundation copy is quite precise in the type of colors that are used. I will go further into this in the later images. Now, the city of Venice is one of the largest town views in almost all copies. And most of the 16th century charts of Venice have inscriptions accompanying the several districts of the city. In the early original copies, Piri seems to have drawn his own observations, but he did not neglect the legend of the city. He says in the text, of course, it's not the foundation copy, it's the, as you can see, it's the Topkapı Palace copy, but he says that it's the city of ordinary fishermen who brought the San Marco relics from Alessandria and founded the city, and he sort of minimizes the rest of the city. However, he seems to have considered Venice shipyard as a rival to Kasımpaşa shipyard, and you can see the arsenal right in the center. This is, right here. And in all the images of Venice, there is always the shipyard shown or drawn with care. But when compared with later copies of the first version, of the second version, the foundation copy and other samples, we see that there's a simpler approach when depicting Venice. Here you see the Vienna manuscript on the right and the foundation copy on the left. As you can see, even the Venetian copy has more detail architecturally. But this is quite interesting because it's more schematic and even geometrical design practically. But when he says, he relates more information about Venice in the text, we don't have these detailed drawings of the city first version, but more elaborate city views of these are two late copies of Kitab-ı Bahriye's, which shows how elaborate the depictions of Venice can certainly be. But more elaborate city views are encountered on the sections of the Mediterranean and the islands. Now, Brindisi, for example, is depicted with care. And of course, Brindisi, he relates in the text that there isn't a built harbor in Brindisi, but a natural harbor, which can accommodate 3 or 4 vessels. And then there's a chain across, 2 big towers, he says, on both sides, and the chain. And there's also an island with a bastion to guard the ships, which have to lay outside. And as a band in this view, the illustrator seems to have used tower-like buildings, as you can see in both versions. they are more reminiscent of European military architecture encountered in many European atlases. Anyway, more examples, of course, among the other examples in the copies, the islands on the Mediterranean are depicted in larger sizes. Of course, the island of Crete, as we see, is also described in detail. And he talks about the history of Crete, Heraklion, Candia, and he says there are 700 villages on the island and goes into detail about all the arbors. He mentions the churches in Crete, and you see several, towers on the depiction. And these are some more versions of Crete that we find on the copies of the first version. And of course, you see that in the foundation copy, it's more detailed. All the islands are much more detailed. Now, of course, when it comes to the depiction of Cyprus, it's described extensively in the text, and he says that it's not like other islands. It's a favored and prosperous island, and there are 4,000 villages, and in each there is abundance of every sort of fruits, oranges and sugar cane. And he goes into much more detail about that, and then he describes the island for seamen, telling where large ships and where small ships can embark, including the Girit, Girine, Feneri, Lamassol, Lefkosa, and Nicosia, of course, and Magosa. But he says Magosa is a beautiful castle with a double harbor, and there is no finer place in Cyprus other than Magosa. And you see all the information. Now, in the later copies Kitab-ı Bahriye with an extended text, as Çiğdem Kafesçioğlu mentioned, there's always a town view of Istanbul, of course, which does not exist in the versions of our copies. But when it comes to the end of the voyage, you know, reaching Istanbul, this is what we get. The one on the right is as you can see, a copy of the first version, and you see the very sketchy drawings. But on the right, the foundation copy, you see, as also Cidan mentioned this morning, they are represented by these islands. Now, Corfu on the Mediterranean, this is also interesting because we have in these three versions that you have all the information underneath, that's why I'm not pointing to them, the first version and the second version. The reason I tried to mention this or put this is that in some late copies of the first version, you do get more painterly-like depictions of some of the islands, and this certainly is an example, because you can see that both the Topkapı Palace copy and the foundation copy are more detailed, more colorful, and of course this will lead to our discussion of who they were made, what the presentation purposes were, etc. Of course, just to remind you again of these two images that we saw this morning, Cairo is extensively illustrated in all the second copies, especially the late second copies of the Kitab-ı Bahriye, and of course we do not have it in the foundation copy. But I mean, this very brief look on the comparative samples, you know, of the early and late examples of the Piri race, when you compare stylistically with earlier copies, as you have seen, you find some new steps in the way that they're colored, and you know how the cities and you know details are much more colorful in the late copies. But now several other maps were produced during the second half of the 16th century. I want to briefly talk about them, because the connection between cartographers and painters that we have been discussing all through, who merged mapping and picturing, certainly reflect the circulation of visual taste in the different art circles on the Mediterranean. Now, this atlas, for example, Atlas Humayun, it's called, has some depictions of the ports. And of course, Genoa is always apparent in most of these atlases. And you see Marseille, and there are groups of buildings, but with some at least excerpts of nature around. And of course, this famous Walter's Art Gallery atlas, and we saw also this morning, is one of the most elaborate ones and much better illustrated. And all the Mediterranean ports are depicted in detail. And of course, especially when it comes to depicting Anatolia and the Black Sea, the depictions of the cities are especially, you know, Istanbul is noteworthy. I'll show it in a minute, but of course, Genoa and Venice, as the two very important ports, are illustrated extensively with groups of buildings, and then you see this you know, the landscape, sort of the nature behind it. And of course, Istanbul, as we can compare with many, many other depictions of the topographical drawings of Istanbul, is very extensive, and it's actually, it's not an imaginary or a symbolic representation of the town, but it does remind the Parthenon style views, but it's more in line with panoramas of Istanbul, often drawn by European travelers as ground level panoramas, and of course the true bird's eye view of Istanbul in perfect geometrical perspective was by Vasori in the 15th century, and it's copied by several other copied in several other sources. But of course, something to note here is again the arsenal, which of course is of great significance for both the seaman and of course the skyline and all those details we heard about in the morning. Now, again, this is interesting because the copy by Brown and Hogenberg of the, famous Istanbul map, Vasori's map, and what you see here is that you see the portraits of Ottoman sultans lined on the border, and he puts a note there saying that they did this to prevent the Turks, whose religion forbade images, from using their maps for their military end. And this is again a note that we should make when we trail all these maps. And of course, Matrak Cinosu, that they talked about this morning, is he was a historian, mathematician, calligrapher, etc. And his works are very significant because his plan views are certainly very significant in the history of Ottoman painting, and forming a genre which is called topographical painting. Of course, the famous Istanbul image is known to all of you, and it's the Ottoman capital with its topography and all the significant historical buildings. And it's still used as a document for the urban tissue of the time. It's not a bird's eye view, as we can see, it's but oriented towards the main peninsula, etc. And of course, the regions less populated were not included. So this is a step in the panoramas or plan views of Istanbul, and in the later samples, it changes. Of course, this image of Baghdad, again, a very important document on the city of Baghdad. This is, of course, during the Suleiman's expeditions in the east, that he was able to accompany him. And this is, again, the town view observed by the artist himself. And, of course, Aleppo symbolized by its famous castle. And again, we have seen this. We have seen Genoa, at least, and also Nice on the volume, which, of course, narrates the Mediterranean expedition. And it's very important because, of course, it was Barbarossa expedition on the Mediterranean. And these plan views are certainly... Some are derived from European samples, but in the background, when you look at them, in view of discussing Ottoman painting of the time, we have to note some details which are very important for developments in the 16th century. Now, military charts and siege plans produced during Suleiman's reign also reflect the connection between cartographers and painters. And this is the siege plan of Belgrade, as you see. And there is, it's a plan view, but at the same time, what you see in the background, in the way the colorful plants attract the eye, of course, that again is a feature very important for developments in 16th century Ottoman painting. Now, this happens, we find these illustrations of all these very significant cities in the Balkans and in various parts in Europe, because, they were certainly, depict or document the Ottoman expeditions in that area. And of course, one of them is this famous Sziget var, a fortress, and of course there are several views about this image, that was it done by an Ottoman artist, or was it an artist of Hungarian origin who did it? And I was going to ask or make a comment this morning, and I said I will speak about it when I talk this afternoon. We have payment records which give us the names of artists of provenances in the Balkans and also in the East, Iran, and you know, all the Balkans and Hungary. So we have to think about this, the provenance, the problem of provenance for artists doing images like this. And of course, this also encompasses cartographic views. Again, another historical illustrated history, the famous Hünername. I don't mention the dates because you see them on the screen. And it was, again, a very panoramic view of Istanbul. And what happens with these images is that you, when they do give you a documentary view of the city at that time, at that date, because when you see the growth of the city on the Golden Horn, on the Galata region, and here is, this is on the right, you can also see that. It's a very small image, but it, you know, it's a historical manuscript, and it's the appearance of a comet, as you can see over the skies of Istanbul. But you see again the urban tissue of Istanbul. Now this is again very interesting because in the 17th century, for example, this is a printed copy of the Atlas Major, as you can see, translated by Bahram el-Demişki with some information from Eastern sources added. And what you see here on the left, and of course you see it also on the map itself, an image of Rome, and it's presented as the Kızıl Elma, the red. I deserve it. The red apple symbolizing the desired land. But so this is another version of these topographical images. Now this is even perhaps more interesting because it shows you, as you can see, a view, an image of Baghdad in a 17th century atlas, but again you see it is a plan view of the city. This is even more perhaps interesting for you because it does show, as you can see, it's a water conduit in Istanbul leading from the Valens Aqueduct to Topkapı Palace. And again, you see the images and the plan of Topkapı Palace and the route depicted in the manner of atlases. And we see these city views in many other media. I just want to conclude with that. It was used in minor arts, and landscapes were painted in albums and boxes, and wooden boxes on walls. And this, for example, is a writing box, and it's in a paper cut technique. But again, it is a view of the Golden Horn. And another sample I want to mention about wall paintings, because these plan-like views were placed as wall painting in many buildings in the capital and the provinces. And of course, the view of Istanbul being the most popular. And you see here in a house near Izmir, a view of Izmir and also Istanbul above and Izmir below. And even in a house in Damascus, again, you see a view of Istanbul in the late 19th century with the bridges. But again, you see it is like one of the town views that we have seen in the late atlases and late works on geography. And the last sample is, as you can see, it's a Greek house in Göreme, and with a view of Edirne on one of its walls, and you see a Greek inscription, and you see an Ottoman inscription, and you see the date, and it certainly, again, is a documentary view of the city with all its major monuments and giving the signature of the city. Now, why I showed you so many variants of these town views is that I think these illustrated maps, atlases, and historical manuscripts, they prove the interconnection of calligraphy and painting, cartography and painting, and they are both documents of geography, history, and the art of painting in that period, throwing light upon the circulation of existing aesthetic values in different circles on the Mediterranean, and they are copied by other cartographers, map makers, and we know that they worked together and they shared sources, and they were individual cartographers, map workshops, and we know there were ateliers outside the court, and especially some documents record that in the Galata shipyard there were artists, and they were called, for example, Kalyonlar Nakkaşbaşı, which is the chief artist of the galleon, or Esnaf-ı Haritaçıyan, which means map makers. And Evliya Çelebi in the 17th century says that these artisans were well-trained people, and they spoke many languages. That's why I want to mention that, especially because we have been talking about this all through. And actually, they had illustrations of, this is in the sources, in the document, that there were fortresses and cities in their ateliers, and they could copy those. And so these artisans may also have even worked for the historical manuscripts. And we know that there were traveling artists. I will just end these with these words because, you know, the Dutch Blau family, creators of Atlas Mayor and Atlas Mineur, presented their works to the French king, Louis XIV, and with these words, geography is the eye and the light of history. Cartographers depict every part of the world, cities, rivers, lakes, and mountains, and tell their stories and legends. Maps should certainly be regarded as presenting geography in the eye of history. They illustrate the artistic milieu of the period and often the cultural legacy of both the artist and the traveling cartographer, their political inclinations, interest in nature, and certainly their own fantasies and memoirs. This interesting merge of mapping and picturing should be the concern of historians as well as the art of painting at the same time, prevailing in various circles in the Mediterranean. Thank you.